connects. It's an essential material for pretty much every builder, whether it's for making a simple release mechanism or lever, or a large complicated design. But there's probably a lot of stuff about this simple building toy that you didn't know you could do. Welcome to Everything You Didn't Know, the Possible series where we take a look at some of the less obvious tips and tricks from a certain material to help you build with that material in a more efficient way. This episode, Everything You Didn't Know About Connects. Before we get started, I would like to point out something. A lot of the tips in this video require one very specific piece, and it's this tiny black piece. Why did I want to tell you this right out front? Well, it has come to my attention that not everyone has these pieces, which I find kind of strange because now I have no idea how I came to acquire so many of them if they're so rare. But anyway, I wanted to try to convince you guys to go to connects.com and buy a handful of them. At 7 cents, they are literally the second cheapest standard size part on connects.com, second only to a quite useless end cap, which, mind you, is only 1 cent cheaper. For only $5, including tax and shipping, you could probably get as many of these pieces as I have, which is obviously enough. But if that's still not enough to convince you to get some, hopefully the many applications in this video of this tiny little black piece will be enough to convince you otherwise. But without any further ado, let's get started. Number one, a black piece and a gray piece can prevent a rod from turning. So as you can see here, I have a little assembly, and the yellow rod is free to rotate. But we want to prevent that. So we're going to use this little thing here and just snap it right onto the yellow rod. To prevent the yellow rod from turning, we're going to slide this all the way to the red connector. But this still doesn't prevent it from turning. What we're going to do now is bend the gray connector back a little, just like this, so that it rides on top of the red connector, just like this. Okay. It was a small movement, but I hope you caught it, because it's very, very important. What that successfully does now is prevents the yellow rod from turning. But what if you need to use this technique in this scenario, where it looks like this half of the circle might get in the way? Well, believe it or not, it doesn't. You just do the same exact thing. Slide it down, tilt it back, and it works perfectly. I use this technique all the time because of how useful it is. But one notable instance was in the Jax Films machine, where I created a Connects structure to hold a stylus. The reason it was so important then was because the stylus had to come down on an iPad in the same place every single time. And I needed a way to prevent the rod that was holding it from turning, so I used this technique. Unlike some of the other tricks on this list, this technique can be applied in so many different ways. If you've ever worked with Connects, chances are you've come across a scenario where you needed to prevent a rod from turning, and it's surprisingly difficult to do. But now, you have this trick. Number two, orange connectors make the best pulleys. In this example, we're going to be using this technique to change the direction that a string is being pulled in. So, the first step is to thread the string through the center hole of the orange piece. Now, if I want to change the direction the string is being pulled to over this way, I turn the orange connector at a 45 degree angle. The next step involves taping it down, which is very simple because there are two ends of the orange piece that are about the same width as a small piece of tape. I'm using this kind, which is very thin, but if you have something that's slightly larger, it shouldn't be a problem, you just let it overhang a little bit. But you have to be careful not to overlap the center hole. So now that everything is taped down, you can effectively pull the string at a 90 degree angle. One of the most recent times I used this technique was in this clip from Domino's vs. Machines Round 2. I actually also introduced this trick to Toothpaste 35 at the ISM this summer. He thought it was pretty cool, so he included it in his physics machine. I don't use this technique as much as I use other techniques, but only because I don't use pulleys as much as I use other tricks. But when I do use pulleys, this is exclusively the way I'll do it. Because it's quick, simple, and one more big one, it is impossible for the string to come out of the pulley and get stuck, which is what you'll see sometimes with other pulleys. And I think that is a big selling point for this technique. Number three, you can actually push two connectors together like this. Before we get started on this one, I would like to briefly mention that you should probably not use this technique unless you absolutely have to. Although I have not run into any problems with this disfiguring my connects pieces, it is probably something you should not be doing on a consistent basis. But that being said, let's take a closer look. So there really isn't that much to this one. Basically, it just comes down to pushing really hard. But I'll do it up close for you to see anyway. So the first thing you do, just place one on the table like this. I find this is the easiest way to do it. Take the other one, line it up, and then just push as hard as you can until you hear the click. Just like that. And now, they're locked together. As I kind of hinted at, I don't use this trick very often, but I did use it once in a screen link clip that I made recently, although you can't really see it too well because it's hidden under a bunch of stuff. The only reason I really included this trick was because I can definitely see the potential for it. I mean, take a look at this. You can pretty much create a completely new length of rod. Each of these connections is two orange connectors snapped together. Alright, moving right along to number four, modifying your yellow connectors to fit Hot Wheels tracks. So as we all know, the top part of a yellow regular connects connector is way too wide to fit into the gap underneath a Hot Wheels track. Well, I was very frustrated with this inconvenience, so I decided to come up with a solution. And long story short, after a lot of trial and error, I ended up with this. It's basically a regular connects connector, but the top part is chopped off to fit the exact width of the groove underneath the Hot Wheels track. And yes, it fits the Hot Wheels track fantastically. Basically, I just took a regular old saw and cut off the top parts to about the middle of the little bump. And then I took a Dremel tool and then sanded down the rest of the little bump so that it was smooth enough to fit into the gap on the Hot Wheels track. The only reason I'm not going into too much detail here about how I did this was because I figure that most people watching won't be doing this technique. In fact, probably only the most advanced machine builders would even consider it. But I decided to include it anyway because I think it's an interesting technique for people to know about. So after I figured out that this was the best design, I ordered 50 of these parts from connects.com. After I did the same modification process to each one, I ended up with a batch of 50. But now I'm only down to about 20, because I gave these away in batches of 10 to different machine builders at the ISM. In fact, Sprice has already used some of these pieces in his pizza delivery machine. As for me, I use these parts all the time. Almost every single screen link clip, machine, and ultimately video, since Challenge Accepted 11, uses these parts. Why is this technique so helpful, though? Well, besides the many, many obvious reasons, it's always nice to have a material that can bridge the gap between two completely different materials, in this case, connects and Hot Wheels track. But the other reason it's so great is because now I can put a Hot Wheels track pretty much anywhere on any connects contraption that I make. And let me just tell you, that is awesome. Number five, using black pieces to prevent connectors from moving along rods. So the concept for this one is pretty simple, and chances are you've come across this at some point. You've got a connector and a rod, and you want to prevent the connector from moving along the rod. Typically, you would use a gray piece, or something like this, and place one on each side to prevent the connector from moving. But it turns out that is not the best option. In fact, placing one of these on each side of the connector will do a much better job, because they grip the rod a lot tighter. Because of this, the connector will have a much better chance of staying in place where you want it. And as always, you can double down if you need even more security. I use this technique fairly often because it can be used in a couple of different ways, but one of the most recent times I've used it that you can actually see it really well is in one of the clips from Dominus vs. Machines Round 2. This technique is useful for an obvious reason, which is that a lot of the time you want something to stay in one place with no chance of moving. And now, with this technique, there's a much more effective way to do that than what you've probably already been doing. Number six, the width of a connector fits perfectly in between the studs on a marble track block. Yes, I know that most people out there do not have the same kind of marble track as I do. In fact, I haven't seen it in any machine video on YouTube, except my own. But I decided to include it anyway on the off chance that someone out there actually does have the same kind as I do, and also, I'm pretty proud of it, and I wanted to share it with you guys. So this is a yellow connector. And this is one of my marble track blocks. And as you can see, the connector fits perfectly in between the studs. If you use this technique in conjunction with two of the modified connects pieces for Hot Wheels track, this technique becomes very helpful for elevating a track to a good height. This technique is so useful, in fact, that I've pre-assembled six of these. It's the exact same thing, but it's taped together in a way that makes it almost impossible to separate. To make the pre-assembled version of this technique, you're going to need some small duct tape, and you want to tear off a strip about as long as the bottom of a connector. Now, you're going to wrap it into a tube so that it sticks to itself, and apply that to the bottom of the connector. Then you're going to place that in between the studs in the block. You're going to have to press pretty hard to get it in there, but once it's in there, it's going to be very hard to remove, which is what you want. Like I said earlier, this trick works really well in conjunction with the modified connects pieces. By varying the length of the rod and the amount of blocks underneath, you can create pretty much any height that you would ever want. And since both of these techniques are already assembled, or can be assembled at a moment's notice, you can see how this greatly increases efficiency when building simpler structures such as a standalone track. Here you can see exactly how much variability you can get with this technique, but also how specific you can be as well. In other words, the height increases only a small amount each time, so chances are you'll be able to find the exact height that you need. Number 7. A tiny circle marks the middle of every connects rod. Here we have an ordinary red rod, and right in the middle of that red rod is a very small circle. That circle is so small, in fact, that I spent a good 10 minutes trying to get my camera to pick up on it. And as you can see, it's still having a hard time focusing. The only reason you can even see it now is because it's reflecting the light differently. If I were to move it around a little bit, you can see that it's actually pretty much the same color as the surrounding material. I'm actually not sure whether Connects actually does this on purpose or not, but I do know that it can be used as a very easy way to find the middle of a rod with 100% accuracy, quickly and easily. Believe it or not, I haven't used this technique. I simply haven't needed to. But just because I haven't encountered a reason to use it, doesn't mean you haven't. So I'm sharing it with you in the hopes that someone else will find more of a use for this neat little trick than I have. That being said, I can definitely see the potential for this trick. For example, finding the middle of the rod is very useful when trying to balance something, because you want to distribute the weight evenly on both sides. Number 8. A way to make two rods connected by an orange connector rotate together as if they were only one single rod. So here's the situation. You've got two rods connected by an orange connector, and the problem is that they spin freely of each other. But you want them to spin with each other, as if they were a single rod. Well, here's how you solve that problem. You certainly could just use the first technique from this video, and just put one of these on each side. But while these are pretty strong and can do the job in most cases, if you're going to be attaching these two rods to something like a connects motor, you probably want a connection that's a lot more secure, which is where the next part comes in. First, you're going to take two gray connectors and snap one on each side. Then, in the remaining two connections, take a yellow rod and snap it in. And there you go. You're done.
I know for a fact that I've used this trick before, but I can't remember where. What I do know, however, is that whenever I figured this trick out, I made a mental note to remember it because I thought it was really useful. The main reason I like this trick so much is because it's quick and easy to put together, but it also works incredibly well. Number 9. The width of two gray spacers is equal to the width of the small size duct tape, which is also equal to the space between the grooves in Hot Wheels track.
So here we have those three items that I just mentioned, and as you can see, they are all the same width. But so what? What can you do with that? Well, let me show you. I found that this technique works great for creating a tipping track that revolves around a connects rod. And once I flip this over, you'll see exactly how I made this. The reason I love this technique so much is because it just looks so perfect. As you can see, all of the widths match up, which I just think makes it look really nice. This technique here matches up all three of the widths. But there are countless other applications for this technique if you just match up two of the three widths. For example, you could use just the duct tape and the spacers, or just the Hot Wheels track and the duct tape, etc.
This is another technique that I used in the Jax Films machine for the trick where I made a ruler with a track on one end rotate. I matched up only the width of the duct tape and the width of the two gray spacers to create a hole that I could put a connects rod through that makes the ruler rotate. Ultimately, the only reason why this one is so useful is because it can be applied in a lot of different ways. Also, it looks nice when all the dimensions match up, which also makes your machines look a little bit more professional. And finally, number 10, the connection between a Kinex rod and a connector is strong enough to hold a string. Personally, I tend to create a lot of Kinex structures that get pulled by string in some way or another, so this technique is a very good one to have around. Basically, all you do is this. Take apart the connection between a rod and a connector. Then, stick the string into the open connection and reconnect the rod. The connection created here is actually surprisingly strong, and if you've done this correctly, it shouldn't come out very easily just by pulling on one end of the string.
While this technique is pretty strong and would probably work just fine, just to be safe, I would recommend replacing it, in most cases, in a full-length machine with something a bit more secure, like actually using tape. That does not, however, mean that this trick is useless. In fact, it works best in arguably the most important part of the building process: testing. Whenever I have a structure that needs to get pulled by a string, I don't like to waste tape, so I use this technique first to make sure that the weight is heavy enough or that the structure rotates correctly, etc. Then, once I get it to work perfectly, I replace that connection with tape. The last time I used this technique was when I was testing the Kinex structure from the Jax Films machine, during the part where a yellow weight pulls it from a horizontal position to a vertical position. I said that I would recommend replacing this technique in a full-length machine with something a bit more secure, in most cases. What do I mean by that? Well, in the Wheezy Waiter machine, I had a small Kinex assembly attached to a string fall off the table and pull a train back. I realized that the Kinex assembly was so small and so light that it had little to no chance of ever disconnecting from the string, so I just left it in. So, there you go, guys. That's everything you didn't know about Kinex. I'm really looking forward to seeing what you guys have to say about these techniques, but more importantly, I'm looking forward to seeing you guys use them. So leave a comment down below telling me which ones you think you will be using the most. And, if you somehow didn't notice, I'm in my new house, and this is my new building area. So, as you can imagine, I'm pretty excited to start on some of the awesome videos I have planned for you guys, so just stay tuned. As always, if you liked the video, don't forget to subscribe. I'd love to get to 600 before Hevesh 5 gets to 600,000. Alright, so that's it for me. I hope you found this video to be very useful, and I hope to see some of these techniques in your videos soon. Bye, guys!